Ladies and gentlemen, very good morning to you. Thank you very much for coming on this beautiful morning. So a couple of things, if I may say, at the outset. First of all, what are we talking about here? Because as you recall, back in December, I think, last year, we also spoke about numbers and intellectual property applications. So this, the distinction is this. Once a year in December, November, we release a survey of worldwide activity in intellectual property in the preceding year. So the last one was about that, you know, what's happening in every single country of the world for which we have data, which is a lot. What's this one about? This one is about the systems that, the international systems that WIPO runs. And in particular, the Patent Cooperation Treaty for international patent applications, the Madrid system for international trademark applications, and the Hague system for international design applications. And two things, perhaps comments on those. One might expect, it's something of an assumption, that the best intellectual property applications pass through the international systems. You know, one might expect that those who have something that they consider to be eminently commercializable will seek protection internationally. And so here we have a very good picture of activity internationally. And the second thing is perhaps point to make is that the systems are of different levels of maturity. So in the case of the Patent Cooperation Treaty, we have 152 countries that belong to it. And so that gives us a very good picture because it's 95% of the GDP worldwide. You know, it's a very good picture. The Madrid system is slightly less mature. It has 97 contracting parties covering about 113 countries. So it's a good picture, but it's not exactly, it's not at the same level as the PCT. And the Hague system is the least mature of the three. That has some 49 contracting parties to the latest act. And it's very much in growth, but we nevertheless can make some insights about it. So, comments on what the results were. And there is a certain monotony to the comments from the last 5 or 6 or 7 years, but nevertheless, let's put the observations out there. And the first is that, you know, in a world in which we are getting messages from the principal, let's say, economic bodies that the world economy's performance is rather sluggish and rather disappointing, what we see here is in marked contrast to that. Because the growth rate in international patent applications is some 7.3%. The growth rate in international trademark applications is 7.2%. And designs, it's 35%. So this is, I think, says something in itself. And what it says is, of course, that the nature of economic activity is more and more, you know, contains a knowledge component more and more, and that these sectors of the economy are tending to outperform other sectors of the economy. It's a generalization, but nevertheless, let's make it. I'd say the second comment, which is again a repetition of a trend, or it is a trend, is that the performance of China is something quite extraordinary. So, in terms of international patent applications, the number of applications from China rose by, what is it, 44%. 44%, you know, that's...
In one year,
44.7%. You know, this is, we're used to, you know, double-digit growth from China, we're used to it climbing very, very rapidly, but 44% is something really quite exceptional. So it takes it, China, in terms of volume of international patent applications emanating from China, to a position which is very close to the first two in terms of volume sources of international patent applications. So if you look at those sources, you have the United States in the first position with I'll give you round figures, 56,000 international patent applications. Japan in the second position, 45,000 international patent applications. China in the third position with 43,000 international patent applications. So if double-digit growth continues from China, and there's no reason why we would expect on recent trends for that not to be the case, we would expect China to move into second position next year, and within 2 or 3 years to catch the United States of America. So I think that is, while it's a story that we have been hearing now for, relating now for several years, it really is quite exceptional. So what other comments can I make to you? Well, the third one, I suppose, is that Asia in general now accounts for 47.4% of all international patent applications, 47, it's almost half of international patent applications. And if you went back merely 10 years, 2006, it was 27%. Now, obviously, the biggest driver in that is China. You know, the nevertheless, 47%, and you can compare that with Europe, 25.6%, and North America, 25.3%. So, here is something that, of course, we've been discussing for years, but it's very apparent. I'm not sure how much you would like me to bore you about the details, because you have the details. Yes. But so perhaps I won't go into more details, but we're happy to talk about any of these, the features of this. Please.
Christiana, the German Press Agency. Can you go back to the basics for the uninitiated?
Sure, sure.
What makes a company file under the WIPO systems as against filing in the US or in Europe?
Well, you do the latter through the former. So, by using our systems, you have an easier method of filing in the United States or Japan or wherever it might be. So typically what an applicant in the patent area or in any other area would do is file a home application, their first application, and then within 12 months they would follow it with a so-called international application, which would cover all of the other contracting parties or so many of them as they may wish. So instead of filing, if you're a German company, instead of filing first in Germany and then after within 12 months, that's the there's a rule about that called priority, and then in filing after 12 within 12 months in United States, a separate application Japan, separate application China, separate application India, and so on, you file one with us, and it covers all of those other countries, 152 other countries. So it's much more efficient. There are certain other advantages, like postponing the costs until you have more information about the likely patentability, the technical nature of the application, how you're getting your money together for investment, and so on. So they have a lot of advantages, which explains why they are the preferred filing route.
And is there any reason why a company would not do that?
Yes, you do have to pay a fee for us, which is extremely modest, you know, extremely modest.
One-off all the countries or country by country?
One-off. It depends on the system, actually, but let's talk about patents. It's one fee. And after it's about 1,400 Swiss francs.
One application,
152 or so countries. That if you are going to file only in three countries, then financially it's cheaper to do it directly in those three than pay the 1,400. So it becomes economical to do it through our system after four applications, basically, not counting the non-financial benefits that go with it too. So if you're certain fields of technology, for example, you might have the capacity to make semiconductors existing only in a limited number of countries, and so you may not seek worldwide protection. You need to seek protection only in those likely competitor markets. But other fields of technology, such as pharmaceuticals, they would typically try to file almost everywhere.
But 1,400 Swiss francs is not going to stop an international company from filing.
It doesn't. It doesn't. It doesn't. Yeah.
So are you kind of confident that the vast majority of big international companies will always file through WIPO?
Well, they do, and but the if you define an international patent application as an application that is filed in more than one country, so two it could be, but could be 100, then we are through our systems come 60% of all of those. 60% of all applications that are filed in more than one country come through our system. Yeah, please.
Laurent Ciro, Swiss News Agency. So you explained the system that gives you a lot of revenues. How much do you get from that, for instance, in 2016?
Some income.
And profit.
Yeah, and second question, do you think that protectionist trade policy from the US under Trump might accelerate the first rank for China, the schedule by when China would become the first rank?
So, on the first question, we derive 96.5% of our revenue through these systems. And about 3.5% of the revenue comes from member state contributions. So,
Can you give in the dollar terms?
Yeah, sure. At least Swiss francs, anyway. And what does that translate into? In round figures, 400 million Swiss francs a year for the total budget. And come down, so for the member state contributions, are about 380 million Swiss francs a year.
We couldn't get it. 400 million, you said?
Swiss francs from per year is our budget in round figures. Sorry?
From the application.
And 380 million from applications. So 20 million, if you like, from member states. So I'm giving you round figures. We can give you exact if you'd like, but those are accurate.
And it keeps growing.
Keeps going where? Up, actually. Keeps going up, yes. Yes.
On the second.
Oh, second one, sorry. Well, look, I don't see its impact on these systems. Obviously, you know, there is a lot one could say if one knew more about the nature of the policies. But on the general tendency that you describe of perhaps, you know, protectionist forces being at work in the world, I don't see an immediate impact on these systems, because these systems actually are passports into other territories, aren't they? Economically, it's protecting your intellectual assets in other markets in which you would like to operate. Now, protectionism might have some impact on your capacity to be able to act in other markets, but these would be instruments that you would continue to use because they give you an advantage.
Ravi.
Okay. Frank, sorry I didn't go through all the figures because I'm not having my specs. But from what you said, it appears that basically this whole patent PCT scenario is one of, there are four or five or seven tigers who completely monopolize the whole thing. Then there are these tortoises, very laggard, slow-moving ones. In fact, they have not been growing at all. Does this imbalance, I mean, this asymmetry, sort of very worrying development in the sense that will the world continue to be in this kind of phase?
Well, two comments on that. First of all, it is, if you like, a measure of technological capacity. So, therefore, it's not the only measure. It's a measure of technological capacity, and it's very interesting, therefore, to have a measure of that and to see what is happening. But my second comment would be, I just gave you a figure saying that, you know, in Asia, 10 years ago, they accounted for 27% of international applications. Last year, it was 47%. I mean, that's not exactly stability, is it? So, now, admittedly, the great driver in that has been China, but also Japan and Korea, Republic of Korea.
Yeah.
Both of those have had good performances too. So, yes, in any given year, you look and you see that there is a large domination of the applications, but there, first of all, there have been changes, and secondly, you know, when you're dealing with technological capacity, you're dealing with something which takes time. It's a long-term game to acquire. You know, it's a long-term game, and you do have increasing performances. So one could cite India.
Sorry? Yeah,
one could cite India, 1,529 applications last year.
As compared to the previous
year? Previous year was 1,412.
So it's about
8% growth.
8%.
Yeah.
As compared to China's.
Okay, it's not the same country, but I would expect that, and there I'm sticking my head out because, you know, we don't know, but I would expect that you will see India's performance continue to rise. Not in the same way as China, it's not the same country, but we are seeing the signs that it is using the international patent system more and more.
Yeah, but beneath this politically correct statement that you made about India.
Thank you, yes. But I'm glad it wasn't politically incorrect.
One has been wearing this for the past 3-4 years, every year. You put a sort of positive picture, while the figures are all around that, you know, in that zone. In fact, I think there were years there were much more than 1,500. It presents some kind of stagnation, despite all the initiatives that have taken place. So, would you really give your actual, you know, serious assessment in the sense that this doesn't quite represent any increase of growth?
Well, my serious assessment would be that when you take all of the policy measures that are being implemented in India at the moment, I would be extremely surprised if we do not see a steadily increasing performance in the use of the international patent system. And I think that is coming through. So, you know, take the number that we just said, 1,500, okay? So, there was a time when you said India files roughly the same amount as Belgium. Belgium filed 1,200.
Sorry?
Belgium filed 1,200 last year.
Yeah.
If you compared it to Canada, 1,500, Canada's 2,300.
Okay.
Okay, so I would say that Canada's not a technologically backward country. So I would say the figures are there. We have to wait, of course. We can't declare a trend yet, but I would be highly surprised if we don't see a steadily increasing performance.
And
that
will be medium term, long term, immediate
term? In the medium term, I would say.
Medium term.
Certainly in the long term, too. You know, but in the medium term.
Christine, one country that it listed here is called unknown. I wonder what that is.
seven countries, we don't have the information about who the country of the address of the applicants, so we just classify unknown. Once we have more information, that will be allocated.
Oh, okay.
It's a small proportion. I mean, we want to have unknown.
Yeah, there's not many of them.
It's very small. It doesn't have an impact on the statistics.
But, sorry, the real question was...
Sorry.
In a nutshell, what is the difference between Hague, Madrid and...
Patent Cooperation Treaty is invention, so it's basically technology.
PCT.
Mm-hmm. Inventions. It's basically technology. Madrid is trademarks, so it is branding. The Hague is designs, so that's the external appearance of products. Furniture, as the principal applicant was Fink from the Netherlands. It's a furniture maker, so it's furniture, fashion, watches, clothing, external and cars, shape. It's the external appearance.
Yeah. Can you elaborate on the systems how many of these applications are rejected in by your contracting parties? What is the failure rate of acceptance?
Yeah, so we can't give you an exact figure on that because that no longer concerns us. What happens with these systems, and they're each slightly different, so it's a little bit difficult to generalize, is that certain phases of the processing procedure are internationalized. So it's one application, one international search, one international preliminary examination, but at the end of the day, the title is granted by the country that's designated. Okay, so that country, that this office, receives information from the system which assists them to take the decision. So we don't have, that's in their ball court. But a rough figure would be, and it's, we're generalizing here because they're different countries, slightly different standards. Rough figure would be 2/3 approval rate for patents. Rough.
But the 1/3 doesn't necessarily get rejected. There are many cases where also the applicant voluntarily withdraws because the applicant feels that.
There's a combination of reasons, and another reason to the one that Carsten mentioned is the applicant might withdraw because what it actually wants to do is to publish the technology. So that happens, we publish it, and then they withdraw, they don't go any further. Why would they do that? Because they don't want someone else to patent it. In publication, bans anyone else from patenting. It's called defensive publication.
But you have two systems: first to invent, first to publish between Europe and America.
No more. First, and it was first to file or first to invent, not publish. Yeah.
Tom,
What about how many of the trademarks are approved and how many of the patent system?
I can't give you that figure, but...
check into it, but numbers are
okay. It's much higher.
It's much higher because...
80-90%.
I mean, typically... typically, a company wouldn't just shoot off an application. I mean, branding is a very important investment decision, and before you would choose a brand, you would search its availability and make sure that you are well advised about its distinctiveness, that nobody else has it, because you're going to be investing a lot of money, not just in the application, but in the advertising, in the image, and how you're going to project it, and so on.
Tom Miles from Reuters. I've got two questions. First one is a bit difficult to express, but looking at the data for those patents, there are obviously some mega kind of peaks of registration, I'm not sure if that's the right word, in places like China and Japan and the US. But it's not a smooth correlation with innovation. I mean, China's numbers are 10 times out of Switzerland, which are 10 times out of Ireland. There's no way that China is 100 times more innovative than Ireland. And you were talking about India sort of gradually progressing, but presumably India would have to have a step change. It's not going to go up like 3% a year or in line with GDP. It's just there are some countries which are totally different from most countries. So I just wonder if you can explain why some countries show these kind of mega numbers and most countries don't. And the second question is about China's patents. Is it any way of sort of looking at the I mean, the quantity is obviously big. Is there any way of looking at the quality? And is it a difference? You know, do you see a different kind of quality of patents coming out of China than you do from elsewhere?
Well, on the first, I think, and maybe Carsten can supplement what I say, it is, as I said, a measure of technological capacity. It's not the only one. So we also publish a Global Innovation Index, which is a much broader look at, you know, some 68 or so different elements that we think are important inputs to an innovation ecosystem and outputs of innovation ecosystem. And that would be a better measure, we would suggest, for overall innovation capacity and performance of a country than just patent figures, which are one element. So there's that. Now, why would different countries have different extents of usage of the system? Well, I think they're probably, of the patent system, there are probably various explanations for that. But we can't discount, you know, demography for a start. So Switzerland is 8 million people. China is 1.4 billion. So one would expect that if there was any similarity in technological capacity, that you would get more applications coming out of China. So demography is obviously important. And we do publish in our reports, and Masayed, next to you, can refer you to these, a measure of applications per GDP and per population. So we do have figures on that, and they would be sounder ways of looking at the matter. But it is obviously complex. Now, the second question was...
About quality versus quality.
Yeah, look, it's a difficult one. It's a very difficult one. And there's a lot of urban legend around this and a lot of anecdotes. The reality is that we do not have a metric for quality. Now, you might say, well, you know, you're really hopeless, why don't you? And I think the answer to that is, if we did, you know, you wouldn't need a venture capital industry. If you could tell what the commercial capacity and potential of an invention at the very first stage, then, you know, you don't need to be going to...
Well, I mean, perhaps I shouldn't have used the word quality, yeah. But I mean, qualitatively, are you looking at a different kind of patent coming out of China? Like, are they all about, you know, basic research or applied, you know, are we looking at things in a different stage?
No, I look, it's, you know, we are vitally interested in this question, as you are.
But by national companies and by subsidiaries based in China?
On the first, let's deal with the first. We can give you areas of technology where they are most active, and that tends to be digital computer technology, telecommunications. You can couple it also with looking at the amount of investment that's going into R&D and the sectors of investment in R&D in China, and we know there that it's in round figures $400 billion US dollars in R&D this year, as opposed to $520 billion US dollars for the United States of America. It's more invested in R&D in China than in the European Union. So on that alone, and given the general policy of emphasis of the Chinese authorities on innovation, emphasis also on the educational system, I would be very wary of making, you know, comments about quality. And if the quality is not there at the moment, it will be there. I think that we will see that translated into commercial, you know, applications. You know, there are, it is also numbers here that we're dealing with, numbers. So,
yeah. Sorry, do you just have a European figure? You know, you said China.
I'd have to look it up, but it is less than, I'm going on the Battelle Institute figures in their R&D report for this year. Yeah.
We have a question here on the right.
Yes, a question on participation of Japan in the A system. If I understand, he made the first application in 2014, and we are still increased, like 2,000% increase between the first and second year, and now between 2016 and 2015, 100% increase. Can you give me details on why this increase?
Sure. So this goes back to the comment I made at the outset that the three systems have different levels of maturity.
Yes.
And the least mature, if you like, is the Hague system. And Japan only recently joined the Hague system, as did the United States of America and as did the Republic of Korea. Before that, it was traditionally had a membership which was largely European. Now, as a result of those three, obviously, extremely innovative countries joining the Hague system, we're seeing these very high growth rates in the design area of 35% this year, 40% last year. But it's on a small volume, you know, and it doesn't have the same geography or geographical coverage that the patent system, the PCT, does. So we will see other countries coming into the system, and it will give us an increasingly better view of design activity worldwide. So Japan's, I think, figures are explained by its recent joining of the system, and they're starting to use it.
If I'm not mistaken, your data doesn't capture defense-related patents, right? Some countries filing also defense-related patents.
Well, yes, it's a complex question. I mean, what is a defense-related invention?
Can be a dual-use product.
For example, yeah, for or GSP,
yeah.
GPS wasn't a military invention. Well, it came out of a military, you know, invention. So, yeah. So, you know, it's hard to say what is. There are civilian uses of drones.
Let me rephrase that. Would the volume be higher if a lot of the products that are not in the public domain and they are basically defense secrets, but they're cutting-edge inventions, would you have even higher traffic?
Look, I would suspect so, because when you look at the... if you decompose the research and development figures, you see that a large component is defense, research and development. And so they're obviously producing something, you know. Most of the time we prefer not to see it, I think, you know, deployed. But the other thing to note is that a number of countries have what they call secrecy provisions. So this is at least the United States, the United Kingdom, France, I believe Germany and others, where they look at home domestic applications, okay, so applications filed by their own constituents, and they have the capacity to pull those from the publication system. It's called secret inventions or defense inventions, and obviously we don't have figures on that.
If it's okay with everybody, one last question.
Is that what's about bribery in the system? I mean, you have countries or patent offices in national levels who are renowned for asking special fees to speed up the process or things like that. Or you have no clue?
No clue, yeah. Huh? No clue. Yeah.
I think Ravi has one last question on this. Yeah.
Your comments on quality, I mean, if you have to make a comparative assessment in terms of countries that file patent applications and in terms of that have been rejected or refused, US, China, Japan, can you give us an indication of how many have they filed and how many have they been rejected or refused?
Well, there are one or two studies on this. I think Webster did one, there are some studies on this. My colleagues can comment perhaps on them. You want to say something, Carsten, or Messiah?
Just
I mean, I don't think there's an obvious conclusion coming out of these studies, because you have both. You have, you know, so what these studies have done, they have looked at...
These are your studies or studies?
No, studies that have been done by academics.
Okay.
They have looked at patent filings that have been submitted to various offices in the world, the same patent filings, and see what happened. And you would find both. You would find, you know, cases where a patent was submitted in the United States and it was not accepted in the United States, but it was accepted in Japan. But you would also find, you know, find it the other way around. It's also very difficult to come to firm conclusions there because the timeline is not the same. It could be that one office looks at a patent at one particular point in time and another office at another point in time, and, you know, offices also use the information that is generated by one patent prosecution in another jurisdiction to inform their own process. We're very happy to point you to these studies, but they don't necessarily will tell you that office is more permissive than another office.
Yeah, why I'm asking this question is that this comparative assessment has become an essential exercise, because you have publications like Economist always slamming the Chinese patents as, you know, quality-wise very poor, they're just in quantity. So while the same comment you don't hear about, say, the patents that are coming or filed by US or Japan. So is there any sort of bias towards these kind of assessments? I mean, does the WIPO come to this conclusion that there is something perhaps to be looked into?
Look, I think that we can't obviously make a comment on that, but two observations. First, you know, it's not for us to say whether there's bias in the comments, you know, the debate about the system. We're giving you the figures and we're seeing trends, and it's... you know, you can draw some conclusions from those figures and trends. I would say that one thing that that we need to pay attention to, however, in the longer term, in the future, is that in a world in which competition is increasingly based on technological capacity and innovation, and in which that the advantages that are derived, commercial advantages that are derived from technological capacity and innovation, are protected by intellectual property, obviously I think we would all be interested in ensuring that there's enough transparency about patent granting processes around the world for us to be able to see if there is any cribbing on or cheating on the application of the standards. And so I don't suggest that there is, and we don't have any evidence to suggest that there is. But I think that this is something that we should look for in the future.
Can I follow up on Robbie's question? Do you have any statistics on, again, key offices in key countries, the average time process and application,
because
the argument has been made, by stalling, you hope your domestic industry will reverse engineer and file an application.
Sure.
Some patent offices are notorious for that.
Sure. No, we do have those. So Masayat has lots of...
What's the average, say, for an application to be examined in the US, and what's the average, say, in Japan or Brussels or Beijing?
That would be difficult to do, because comparing the offices would be difficult. The reason for that is sometimes the applicant can delay the process.
Yeah, assuming a normal, no delays, no hiccups. What's the average?
Look, you're looking rough. Going to give you a rough figure, right? You're looking at about, it differs. So in Korea, they're processing them in under 20 months, you know? Under 20 months, yes. European patent organization, you're looking at more than 36 months. But they would also tell you that their quality of their process is the highest. You know, so we're into a different assessment, self-assessments here. And the other thing is that it depends on the field of technology. So you'll find that it's much longer in the biotech area than it is in the IT area. Yeah, so generalization is
fine.
It also depends on the average length of pendency, depends on the field of technology. So it's longer in the area of biotechnology, generally.